Hello everyone, I'm Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. In this very series, we pick up some important financial topics and we try to discuss them with the help of different questions. So for all those who are there for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon for all latest updates and notifications. You can also join our Telegram group. In this very group, we share some free quizzes as well as the updates for all our latest videos. So let's move on to question number one now, which says, the SEBI's board approved the framework for accredited investors. While SEBI did not lay out the criteria to determine an accredited investor during the meeting, it highlighted the features of new framework proposed by the board. Which of the following correctly states those features? So recently, SEBI's board had its meeting and there were different decisions taken, different amendments which have been suggested for different regulations. So we'll discuss few of those decisions and amendments today. One of them is related to accredited investors. If you remember, then SEBI came up with a consultation paper where it introduced the concept of accredited investors and invited some comments on that very proposal. So now in this very meeting, SEBI has approved the framework for having the accredited investors. So in that very framework, although the detailed framework is not yet out, but they have talked about some features of that framework, what that framework will include, then what are the benefits for the accredited investors. So let's just discuss that first and then we'll come back to our question. So talking about the framework now, SEBI, as I've already mentioned, SEBI has approved the framework. So what SEBI has said, the board of SEBI has said, they say that accredited investors are a class of investors who will be well informed and advised or well advised about the investment products. Jinko investment products ke baare mein achhi knowledge hai, well informed hai, wo hote hai accredited investors. In the proposal which came up in the consultation paper, which I'm talking about the consultation paper of SEBI, they talked about the criteria for your accredited investors. This was the criteria that the annual income should be 2 crores or more, or the net worth should be more than or equal to 7.5 crore with some portion invested in financial assets. Or there was another criteria also where the annual income and net worth were different provided you maintain some financial assets. So in this very meeting, they have not cleared who will be the accredited investors, what will be the exact criteria, whether the same proposal has been accepted or not. Soon the information will be out, but as of now, they have mentioned that the well-informed investors will be the one who will be categorized under your accredited investors. Moving ahead to the features, I have already told you that SEBI has laid down a criteria for your, has basically approved a framework for your accredited investors. And what will that framework include? What are its features? First is, it will provide the details about the eligibility criteria for accredited investors. It will tell that which individual, Hindu undivided family, family trust, sole proprietorship firm, partnership firm, trust or a body corporate will be categorized as an accredited investor. So for that, SEBI will prescribe certain financial parameters, certain information on the basis of which these different individuals or firms can be considered as the accredited investors. So next is, next, what this framework will include? It will include the details with respect to the eligible subsidiaries of depositories and the stock exchanges which will act as a accreditation agency. Jo agency aapko status degi, aapko issue karegi status ki aap accredited investors ho, to un wo agencies ka kya eligibility criteria rahega, wo is framework mein discuss hoga. So kaun se depository ke subsidiary ya stock exchanges aapke accreditation in the agencies ki tarah act karenge, jo aapko accredited investors ka status denge, wo bhi is framework mein details aayengi. Next is the modalities of the accreditation and the procedure to avail the benefit related to that. So kya aapka manner hoga of getting the accredited investor status, what will be the benefits which you are going to get, all these things are going to be a part of your framework which will come up in detail related to this accredited investor thing. Now talking about the benefits which accredited investors will get. कोई भी investor, कोई भी firm जो है वो अपने आप के लिए एक accredited investor का status क्यों लेना चाहेगी? Obviously if they are going to get some benefits, then only they will take the status. So the benefits include first that the accredited investors will get the flexibility to participate in investment products with an investment amount lesser than the minimum amount prescribed. So there's certain minimum amount which you need to invest when you go for alternative investment funds, when you go for portfolio manager, when you go for other kinds of investments. Okay, there are rules and regulations for your alternative investment fund, portfolio manager regulations are there. So some relaxation will be given to these accredited investors in that regard. Okay, you as an accredited investor need not meet that minimum amount which has been prescribed. Then second thing is that the alternative investment fund for accredited investors, where each investor invests a minimum of 70 crores, will get the relaxation from regulatory requirements. So agar aap minimum 70 crores ka amount invest kar rahe ho AIFs mein, to aapko kuch relaxation milega. The relaxation will be related to some regulatory requirements like portfolio diversification norms, some conditions for launch of schemes, extension of the tenure. So you are going to get some relaxations in these schemes as well. Then we have that if they are as an accredited investor, they are investing a minimum of 10 crores, then with the registered PMS, that is your portfolio manager, then they can avail the relaxation. Another relaxation they can avail in that regard also with respect to how much investment they have to do in unlisted securities and can enter into negotiated agreements with the PMS provider. So kuch relaxations regulations mein milengi agar wo kuch minimum amount as a accredited investor invest kar rahe hain. They will also get the flexibility to determine the limit and the mode of payment to the investment advisor. So if the accredited investors are the clients of investment advisors, to unko kab payment karni hai, kis mode se karni hai, us pe bhi kuch relaxations milengi, kuch flexibility milegi ki apne hisab se wo contractual agreements kar sakte hain investment advisors ke saath. So these will be few benefits. Why will one take a status of an accredited investor? That one who, because they will get some relaxations in different rules and regulations which govern the system. Okay, now moving back to our question, which of the following correctly states those features? So first one is incorrect, which says that institutional investors who have the financial expertise will be eligible for accredited investor. No, any individual, any proprietorship firm, partnership firm, corporate, they can become. Institutional investors are the categorized as the QIBs. Okay, उसके अगर आप उनको भी accredited investor बना दोगे तो उनके और QIBs के बीच difference क्या रहेगा? Institutions which have the expertise, the knowledge, they are categorized as QIBs, who have financial knowledge, who invest in large amounts, okay. But if an individual, if a proprietorship firm, partnership firm meets the criteria which will be prescribed by SEBI, then they will be considered as an accredited investor. So this is incorrect. Remaining two are correct. So answer is option D. Now moving on to question number 2, which says, which of the following is not an amendment made by SEBI's board in a meeting, in the recent meeting relating to LODR regulations which pertain to provisions of independent directors. So SEBI has come up with some amendment to your LODR regulations, and those amendments relate to the provisions applicable to independent directors. So let us see what amendments have been made, and then we will see which of these is not a correct amendment. So LODR regulations jo hain usme kuch amendments kiye hain SEBI ke board ne, jahan pe independent directors se related jo provisions hain usme kuch changes laye gaye hain. So wo changes kya hain wo hum log dekhte hain. First set of changes is related to appointment, reappointment and removal of independent directors. So what are those amendments? First is that if any independent director needs to be appointed, he needs to be reappointed, or he needs to be removed, in all the three cases, a special resolution needs to be passed in that regard. So a special resolution of the shareholders of all listed entities is needed. Secondly, the process to be followed by nomination and remuneration committee has been elaborated and made a bit more transparent. So nomination and remuneration committee selects the candidates, who will be appointed as the independent director. So that process has been made more elaborated, more transparent, where you need to tell that what is the skill set required for the independent directors, why this person will fit in this very criteria. So the things have been made more elaborated and transparent. Third is that the composition of the nomination remuneration committee has been modified. So what's the modification? Instead of having majority of independent directors, now 2/3 of independent directors are needed. So jo nomination or remuneration committee hogi, pehle usme majority independent directors hi honi chahiye thi. Ab ho gaya hai ki 2/3 jo hai unme se wo independent directors hone chahiye. And next is that shareholder approval will be needed for appointing the directors, including your independent directors. And the time has also been prescribed that when you need to, within what time you need to take the approval. So shareholder ka approval necessary hai jab bhi aapko kisi director ki ya kisi independent director ki appointment karni hai. So these are the rules related, the amendments related to appointment, reappointment and removal of your independent director. So first is what you need to take, you need to pass a special resolution. Then nomination remuneration committee process has been elaborated and made more transparent. And third is that the composition of NRC is changed and appointment of directors and independent directors will require the shareholder approval within a time span. Next set is related to the eligibility criteria. So if a key managerial person or an employee is to be appointed as an independent director, then 3-year cooling off period is needed. So a waiting period is needed of 3 years after a KMP or an employee of the promoter group of companies need to be appointed as an independent director. And second is that if there are any relatives of the employees of the company or employees of the holding or subsidiary or associate company, then they can become independent directors and this cooling off period requirement will not be applicable to them. So, jo bhi employees ke relatives hain, wo bhi independent directors ban sakte hain. और उन्हें ये cooling off period की जो requirement है, इसको fulfill करने की ज़रूरत नहीं है, ये next amendment है. Further, talking about the resignation of independent directors. So if an independent director resigns, then proper disclosure needs to be made about his resignation letter and what was his present position, kahan kahan wo director tha, kya wo kahan kahan board mein, committees mein uski membership thi. So the things needs to be disclosed, okay? Proper disclosure of your resignation letter specifying the directorships and the membership of that independent director in different board committees. And 1-year cooling off period is needed if an independent director transitions into a whole-time director in the company. So, agar independent director whole-time director banne ja raha hai, to 1 year ka cooling period, gap period, waiting period chahiye. And last set is related to the audit committee. So, with respect to audit committee, what changes have been suggested? The changes include that 2/3 of the members of the audit committee will be independent directors and they will approve all the related party transactions. So if a business enters into a transaction with some party with whom they already have some business interest or some common interest, those transactions are related party transactions. So audit committee needs to approve those transactions and 2/3 members of that committee should be independent director. This is the next amendment. So these were some set of amendments. Now talking about the question, which of these is not an amendment? So B is incorrect. It's not an amendment because it's not 1/3 independent directors. The composition of NRC is not 1/3 but 2/3 independent director instead of existing requirement of majority of independent directors. This is the point which I am talking about. Okay. Now moving on to question number 3, which says the country's mutual fund regulations have been amended and asset management companies have been directed to put a minimum amount of money from their own account every time a mutual fund scheme is launched. AMCs will have to make an investment contribution as a skin in the game. Which of the following correctly states this amended amount that needs to be invested by AMCs? So, let us have a look at it. SEBI has made some amendments to the mutual fund regulations. Mutual fund related kuch regulations hain, unme SEBI ne amendment kiye hain aur kuch directions diye gaye hain asset management companies ko. Some directions have been given to the AMCs, to the asset management companies who manage your mutual fund where you are making an investment. So those companies have to put a minimum amount of money from their own account every time a mutual fund scheme is launched. जब भी वो कोई म्यूचुअल फंड स्कीम लॉन्च करेंगे इन्वेस्टर्स के लिए, तो असेट मैनेजमेंट कंपनीज को खुद भी उस म्यूचुअल फंड में कुछ पैसा लगाना होगा, कुछ इन्वेस्टमेंट करना होगा, एंड दे विल हैव टू मेक एन इन्वेस्टमेंट एज अ कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन एज द स्किन इन द गेम. मतलब उनको भी उसमें पार्ट लेना होगा, वो भी उस चीज से अफेक्ट होंगे. दैट इज वॉट वी मीन बाय स्किन इन द गेम. यू विल ऑल्सो बी एक्सपोज टू द gains which might come up from that very mutual fund, or the losses which might come up, the risks associated. You will be associated with the same risk as the investors are going to be for whom you are launching that mutual fund. So if you will also be the part of that mutual fund, then the you will make sure that you work in a more cautious manner, so that because your money will also be invested over there, so you will be more cautious and it will protect the investors and they would also like to participate. So what is the requirement which has been specified at present? If we see, then these mutual fund, the AMCs who are launching any mutual fund, they also need to make some investment, and the present investment amount was 1% of the amount raised in the new fund offer. जो भी आप नया mutual fund offer कर रहे हो उसमें जो भी पैसा raise होगा उसका 1% या 50 lakh or 50 lakh, whichever is less. This is the existing provision. But now what they have specified under these amendments, that the amount which will be invested will depend upon the risks associated with the mutual funds. So if that mutual fund is a really very riskier one, then more amount needs to be contributed. And if it's less risky, then less amount needs to be contributed. So higher the risk of losses, bigger has to be the minimum contribution made by AMC. Now talking about why this amendment has been made, SEBI's latest move assumes significance in the backdrop of few cases in past 3 years where many mutual fund investors have suffered losses because of high risk instrument or high exposure to a single sector. Now, wherever they have invested, the mutual fund investors, either those instruments were really very high risk instruments, or they were made to invest the entire amount in one single sector, because of which mutual fund investors suffered losses. उनको जो एसेट मैनेजमेंट कंपनीज थी वो ऐसा म्यूचुअल फंड ऑफर करते थे जो उनकी रिस्क प्रोफाइल से मैच नहीं करता था, या सारा वैसा एक ही इंडस्ट्री में इन्वेस्ट करा देते थे, एक ही सेक्टर में इन्वेस्ट करा देते थे, और जब वो सेक्टर नहीं अच्छा परफॉर्म करता था दे लॉस्ट अ लॉट ऑफ अमाउंट. सो व्हेन नाउ द एसेट मैनेजमेंट कंपनीज विल ऑल्सो बी अ पार्ट ऑफ दैट म्यूचुअल फंड, दे विल मेक श्योर दैट द रिस्क आर प्रॉपरली बैलेंस्ड. सो अगर वो खुद अपना पैसा लगा रही है कंपनी, तो वो मेक श्योर करेंगे कि रिस्क बैलेंस रहे, एंड इफ रिस्क आर बैलेंस देन इन्वेस्टर्स विल ऑल्सो गेट द बेनिफिट. सो सेबी दिस मूव विल मेक AMCs मोर कॉशियस वाइल लॉन्चिंग द म्यूचुअल फंड स्कीम्स. सो वो ऐसी स्कीम्स बनाएंगी जिसमें वो खुद भी पार्ट लें तो वो अच्छा परफॉर्म करें. दैट्स वाई दे आर मेड टू टेक पार्ट. इट विल कर्ब मिस सेलिंग. वो गलत टाइप के प्रोडक्ट्स अलग टाइप के रिस्क प्रोफाइल वाले इन्वेस्टर्स को सेल नहीं करेंगे. It will curb mis-selling because they will also be a part of that scheme now. It will make sure that the fund managers allocate the public money more judiciously to curb the risk of losses. They will make sure that money is properly invested in correct schemes, because if there will be losses, they will also suffer the losses because they have also invested the amount. So it will make sure that that thing does not happen. This is the reason why this amendment has been made. So if we move back to the question and identify the correct answer, the answer is option A, because this is the existing requirement which has now been removed, and this is the new criteria specified that it will be based on the level of risks. Now moving on to last question, which says, identify the statements incorrectly related to debt to GDP ratio. So let us see, understand a bit about this ratio, and then we'll come back to our question. So recently the India's debt to GDP ratio is at a 14-year high level. It reached 58.73%. If you compare it with other countries, it is not that high. Okay, other countries are there like Japan, which have more than 200% of this very ratio. But India's ratio is this, but still it is high. And last year it was 51.6%. So let's see, what is this ratio? Why has this risen? Debt to GDP ratio, as the name suggests, is equal to the debt which has been taken by the government upon the GDP. What is the value of goods and services which you are producing, and how much debt you are taking? Okay, when you express your debt with respect to GDP, it will show whether you are generating enough amount to pay your debt or not. So it will gauge a country's ability to repay its debt. It's the ratio of country's debt to GDP. Kitna aapka GDP hai aur kitni aapki debt hai, वो रेशियो आपका होता है डेट टू जीडीपी रेशियो, जो बताता है कि कितनी आपकी डेट पेइंग एबिलिटी है, कितना जीडीपी आप यूज कर सकते हो टू पे योर डेट्स. So how can you interpret this ratio? If this ratio is high, that means this is debt upon GDP. So if this ratio is high, that means your debt is really very high. So it might happen that you are not able to repay. Okay, aapki debt aapke GDP se bhi zyada hai aur itna zyada hoga ye ratio, wo ye batayega ki aapne bahut zyada debt le rakhi hai. और अगर आपने बहुत ज़्यादा डेट ले रखी है तो चांसेस हैं कि आप उसको रीपे नहीं कर पाओगे. देर इज़ अ रिस्क ऑफ डिफॉल्ट एंड उसकी वजह से आपकी फाइनेंशियल मार्केट्स में, आपकी डोमेस्टिक मार्केट्स में काफ़ी पैनिक हो सकता है. सो हायर रेशियो इंडिकेट्स लेस लाइकली अ कंट्री विल बी एबल टू रीपे इट्स डेट. जितना ज़्यादा डेट है तो उतनी कम एबिलिटी हो जाएगी कि आप उसको बेटर रीपे कर पाओगे, क्योंकि GDP के मुकाबले आपने बहुत ज़्यादा डेट ले रखी है. इतना पैसा आप जनरेट नहीं कर रहे जितने कि आपने डेट ले रखी है, तो आपको पे बैक भी तो करनी पड़ेगी. सो द हायर द रेशियो लेस लाइकली अ कंट्री विल बी एबल टू रीपे द डेट, विच इन टर्न इंक्रीजेस द रिस्क ऑफ डिफॉल्ट एंड द रिस्क ऑफ डिफॉल्ट इंक्रीजेस द चांसेस ऑफ हैविंग अ फाइनेंशियल पैनिक इन द मार्केट्स. सो अ हाई डेट टू GDP रेशियो इज अनडिजायरेबल फॉर अ कंट्री बिकॉज इट इंडिकेट्स अ हाई रिस्क ऑफ डिफॉल्ट. So there has been a study conducted by World Bank, and according to that study, if this ratio exceeds 77%, okay, then it might have an adverse impact on the economic growth. So India's ratio is not that very high if we see this. Now talking about why India's ratio has risen, we are seeing that it's at a 14-year high amount. So pandemic has caused this ratio to rise. Because of the pandemic, government expenditures have increased and so have their borrowings. So economic contraction due to the pandemic forced the governments to borrow a record amount to meet the revenue shortfall. We have seen the fiscal deficit widening, okay, and we have also seen economy shrinking, so our GDP will be affected because of that. So Union government debt will include your amount raised through treasury bills, bonds, securities, and we have seen that government has increased its borrowings through these very instruments. So such borrowings have increased. Also, the higher debt to GDP ratio was mainly due to GDP contraction. Hamara GDP contract hua hai, economy is not functioning well due to the pandemic. That's one of the major reasons for a rise in this ratio. And secondly, our debts have risen, so this ratio has risen. Okay, so this was all about the debt to GDP ratio. And from the question, if we had to identify the incorrect statement, the first one is correct. The third one is also correct. Second is incorrect because it says that the lower the ratio, less likely country will be able to repay. No, the higher the ratio, the less the country's ability to repay. So incorrect statement is second one, right? So the question should be identify the correctly related statements, correctly related, not incorrectly related. Okay, so the correct ones are first and third. This was all for today's session. I hope the session was useful for you all. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.